Every time I go, I don't mind giving a lot of my business, because what's my business? I mean, my business is basically good.
Like the trains, too. They don't bother me. Well, some of the times they bother me, some of the times they don't. The one goes up by my house every 13 minutes.
Doc actually lives up in Baltimore, but everyone in Laramie knows him. He's also not really a doctor.
He used to carry cattle, them trains. Now they carry diapers, cars.
I grew up in Cody, Wyoming. April Silva, university student. Laramie is better than where I grew. I'll give it that.
It's a good place to live. Good people, lots of space. Now, when the incident happened with the boy, there was a lot of press that came down here. Oh, well, actually, one day they followed me down to the crime scene. Let me tell you, it was a beautiful day. Absolutely gorgeous day. You know, real clear and crisp. And the sky, it was just that blue, you know, that you just can't paint, you know? Just sky blue. Just gorgeous. And the mountains in the background, a little snow on them, and there was one reporter lady person that was there, and she said,
"Well, who found the boy? Who was out there anyway?"
And I said, "Well, I mean, it's a pretty popular place for hiking, and you know, mountain biking, horseback riding. It's just close to town." And she looked at me and she said,
"Who in the hell would want to run out here?"
And I'm thinking, "Lady, you're just missing the point. I mean, all you gotta do is look around you, see the mountains, hear the birds, smell the air, just take in what's around. They were just nothing but the story. I didn't feel judged. I felt that they were stupid. They're missing the point. They're all just missing the whole point."
I must tell you, when you first told me you were thinking of coming here, I wanted to say, "You kicked me in the stomach. Why are you doing this to me?" But then I thought, "That's stupid. You're not doing this to me." And more important, I thought, "We've had so much negative closure on this whole thing." When it first happened, the student started to talk, but then the media started and all dialogue stopped. You know, I love my students because they're free thinkers. And you may not like what they can say because they do tend to be very redneck, but they're honest and they're truthful. There's a dynamic here that didn't have when I was teaching in the Midwest or North Dakota, because there was all that puritanism that dictated how they thought. They weren't able to have an opinion, and you couldn't get them to express an opinion. And quite honestly, I'd rather have an opinion that I don't like and have that dynamic in education. There's a student I think should talk to. His name is Jedediah Schultz.
It's hard to talk about Laramie, to tell you what Laramie is for us. If you would have asked me before, I would have told you that Laramie is a beautiful town, secluded enough that you can have your own identity. A town with a strong sense of community. Everyone knows everyone. And now, after Matthew, I tell you, we're a town defined by an accident, a crime. We've become Waco. We've become Jasper. And we may be able to change that, but it'll sure take a while. I've lived in Wyoming my whole life. The family's been in Wyoming, well, generations. Now, when it came time for me to go to college, I knew my parents couldn't afford to send me to college. And they had this competition each year, this Wyoming State High School competition. And I knew if I didn't take first place in duets, that I wasn't going to get a scholarship. And so I went to the theater department of the university looking for a good scene. And I was like, I need a killer scene. He was like, "Here you go. This is it." It was from Angels in America. And I read it. And I knew that if I did a good enough job, I could win best scene. So when the time came, I told my mom and dad so that they come to the competition. And they have to understand. My parents come to everything. Every hockey game, every ball game, everything I've ever done. And they took me into their room. And they told me that if I did that scene, that they would not come see me in the competition. Because they felt that it was wrong, that homosexuality is wrong. They felt that strongly about it, that they didn't want to come see their son be probably the most important thing he'd done to that point in his life. I didn't know what to do. I have never, ever gone against my parents' wishes. So I was worried. But I decided to do it. And all I can remember from that night is that when we were done, me and my scene partner, we came up to each other, we shook each other's hands, and there was a standing ovation. Oh man, it was amazing. And we took first place, and we won. And that's how come I can afford to be here at this university, because of that scene. It was one of the best moments of my life, and my parents weren't there. It was the one thing my parents didn't see me do. And looking back at it, I think, why did I do it? Why did I oppose my parents? Because I'm not gay, so why did I do it? And I guess the only honest answer I can give is, well, I wanted to win. It was a good scene. It's like the best scene. Do you know Mr. Kushner? Maybe you can tell.
Company member Andy Harris.
Today, for the first time, you met someone who has a new master shepherd, Trish Stagler, a small shop owner in town.
Matt used to come into my shop. That's how I knew him.
She referred to him as Matt instead of Matthew. Will you go by Matt to everyone?
Well, the 2nd of October, we get a call about a 10 after 7.
Doc O'Connor.
It was Matthew Shepard. He said, could you pick me up at the corner of 3rd and Gray? So anyhow, I pull up to the corner to see who? Matthew Shepard. He's a little guy, you know, 5'2", soaking wet, measured 97 pounds tops. They said the papers he was about 110, but I wouldn't believe that. They also said he was about, you know, 5'5", but this guy was really about 5'1", maybe 5'2". So anyhow, I'm gonna try and go in steps, you know, so you can better understand the principle of this man. So I pull up and I roll down the window, and he walks up to me and says, are you Matthew Shepard? And he says, yes, I am Andy. But I don't want you to call me Matthew or Mr. Shepard. I don't want you to call me anything. My name is Matt. I want you to know, I am gay. And tonight, we're going to go to a gay bar. Do you have any problems? And I say, are you paying? Okay. Larry doesn't have a gay bar. For that matter, neither does Wyoming. So keep us hiring me. Take him all the way to Fort Collins, Colorado, about an hour away. Matt was a blunt little shit, see what I'm saying? But I liked him, because he was straightforward. Maybe gay, but straightforward.
I don't know, you know. How does one person ever tell about another? You should talk to my sister or me. She was a close friend.
We never called him Matthew, actually. Most of the time, we called him Choo-Choo, you know, because we used to call him Matt-Choo, and then it just turned into Choo-Choo. Whenever I think of him, I can just picture his incredible beaming smile. I mean, he'd just walk into the room and he'd light the whole place up. He used to come in every day and he'd sit at the end seat and talk to me about what he'd seen on CNN or MSNBC. That was like his whole big interest, you know, was like political affairs. He was just so smart with all these politics, but not so smart on common sense things. But he came to Laramie to go to school.
Matthew is very shy when he first came.
John Peacock, Matthew Shepard's academic advisor.
Almost to the point of being somewhat mousy, I would say. This is his new home, and he was struggling to fit in, but this is his new home, and he was making that very clear. And this mousiness, this shyness, gave way to an individual that was very excited on this journey that they're going to embark on. And when this happens, this person begins to bloom a little bit. And he decided to settle on human rights. And he began saying things like, wow, I can be important, and I can do really great things here.
I did hear from Matthew about 48 hours before his attack, and he had told me that he had joined the gay lesbian group on campus. He was excited, you know? He was getting ready for Pride Week and whatnot. He was actually happy about being here.
And in retrospect, and I can only say this in retrospect, of course, I think that's where this is all headed, towards human rights, which only adds to the irony and tragedy of all this.
My understanding when I first came here,
Catherine Connelly,
is that I was the first out lesbian gay faculty member on campus, and that was in 1992, so that wasn't that long ago. I was asked that interview what my husband did, and it came out then. Do you want to know a funny story? When you first get here as a new faculty member, there's all these sorts of things you have to do. And so I was sitting in my office and I noticed that this woman called. I was thinking y'all's health insurance or something like that. So I called her back and I could hear her. She is working on her keyboard, clicking away. And I go, "This is Kathy Connolly returning your call." And she goes, "Oh, it's you." And I thought, this is bizarre. And she goes, I hear you're gay. I hear you are." And I was like, "Uh-huh." And she goes, "I hear you came here as a couple." "I'm one too. Not a couple, just a person." And so she was kind of lesbian who knew I was coming and wanted to come over and meet me immediately. And she later told me she'd one of the lesbians who wouldn't want to be seen with me. That I would irreparably taint them. That just to be seen with me could be a problem.
When I came here, I knew it was going to be hard as a gay man.
Jonas told her.
But I kept telling myself, people should live where they want to live. And there will be time, I will go to Denver, and I will go to Gabriel. People will ask me, where was I from? I say, Laramie, Wyoming. I mean, so many men who came from Wyoming. So many gay people who grew up here, and they're like, "This is no place I can live. How can you live here? I have to get out. Grr, grr, grr." But every once in a while, there will be a guy. "Oh gosh, I miss the army. I mean, I really love it here. I want to live here." And they're like, "If that's the place you want to live, do it. I mean, imagine you have more gay people. Stay in a small town." But it's easier to say than done, of course.
My dear brothers and sisters, I am here today to bring you the word of the Lord. Now, I have a simple truth that I tell to my colleagues, and I'm going to tell it to you today. The word is either sufficient or it is not. Scientists tell me that human history, that the world is 5 billion or 6 billion years old. After all, what's a billion years, give or take? The Bible tells me that human history is 6,000 years old. The word is either sufficient or it is not.
Ah, the sociology of religion in the West.
Stephen Mead Johnson, the Unitarian minister.
Dominant religious traditions are everywhere. It's not just Salt Lake, you know. They're all over the place down here. They're like jam on toast down here.
The Mormon church has a little different thing going on that irritates some folk.
Doug Laws, state ecclesiastical leader of the Mormon church.
And that is, we believe that God still speaks to man today. We don't think it happened and some folk just gone and read it in the Bible. No, God speaks to us today and we believe that. We believe that the prophet of the church has the authority and the right to receive inspiration and revelation from God.
Now, on the panel to the left of my spectrum is me and the Unitarian Church. Now, Unitarians are by and large humanists, many of whom are atheists. I mean, we're not even really sure if we're a religion at this point. Now, to the right of my spectrum, we have Father Roger. And to his credit, he did not equivocate at all when this happened. God bless him. He held the vigil for Matthew that very night.
I was really jolted because, you know, when we decided to do the vigil, we wanted to get other ministers involved. And we called some of them. And they were not going to get involved. And he was like, "We are going to just sit back and wait and see which way the wind is blowing?" That angered me immensely. We are supposed to stand out as leaders in our community. And I thought, wow, what's going on here?
God has set boundaries, and one of our responsibilities is to learn. What is it that God wants? So you study scripture, you look to your leaders, and then you get a feel for what the bounds are. And once you get a feel for what the bounds are, you learn what's out of bounds. A proclamation came out about the family. A family is defined as one man, one woman, and children. That is a family. That's about as simple as you can state it. There's no sexual deviation in the Mormon church. No, no, no leniency. We just think it's out of bounds.
I warn you, you will be mocked. You will be ridiculed for the singularity of your faith, but you you will let the Bible be your guide. It's in there. It's all in there.
Christian pastors, many of the conservative ones at least, were silent on this. Conservative Christians use the Bible to say, it says here in the Bible. Now, most Americans believe, and they do, that the Bible is the Word of God. And how are you going to fight that?
I am a Biblicist. Which means, the Bible does not need me to be true. The Bible is true, whether I believe it or not. The Word is either sufficient, or it is not.
I arrived in Laramie on September 15th. I looked around. Tumbleweed, cement factory, and I said to myself, what the hell am I doing in Wyoming? Now, a few weeks later, I figured out what the hell I'm doing in Wyoming.
Today, Barbara and I went to the Fireside Cafe, which is the last place that Matthew has seen in public.
Fireside. Definitely feels like a college bar with beautiful tables and a stage area at the karaoke. Still, the few regulars in the late afternoon were hardly the college crowd.
The first person we talked to was Matt Nicholson, the owner of the bar.
My great-great-grandfather moved here in 1862 and opened Laramie's first opera house, the Old Blue Front. And in 1870, Grandma Louisa Swain cast the first woman's ballot in the free election in the world. And that's how come Wyoming is known as the Equality State. So what I want to do is reestablish my bar business as the Old Blue Front Opera House in Good Time Emporium. That's right, I want to have a restaurant, I want to have a gift shop, I want to have a pool hall and do all that shit, you know? Every nice ladies' night. So, the Fireside is the first step towards the Old Blue Front Opera House and Good Time Emporium.
So, what about the night Matthew Shepard was here?
Well, Matthew came and sitting right where you're sitting, just hanging out. Well, if you want to talk to somebody, you should probably talk to Matt Galloway. He was a kid bartending that night. You have to meet him. His character stands for itself. Hey, is Galloway bartending tonight?
Alright, so I'm going to make this brief, quick, get it over with, but it'll be everything, factual, just the facts. Here we go, 10 o'clock, I clock in, usual time, Tuesday nights, 10:30, Matthew Shepard walks in alone. He sits down, and he orders a Heineken.
Philip Lee, friend of Matthew Shepard.
Matt likes to drink Heineken, and nothing else. Heineken, even though you pay $9.50 for a six-pack. You can always buy the same beer.
So, what can I tell you about Matt? If you had 100 customers just like him, I swear it'd be the most perfect bar I've ever been in, okay? And you know, it's nothing to really do with sexual orientation or anything. No, it's, you know, absolute mannerisms. Taking care of me, as in tips, everything. You know, politeness, clean cut, dress nice. You know, some people walk in, they sit down, they say, please, thank you, you know, offers intellect within the vocabulary. Now, Matthew didn't really seem to be waiting for anybody, just to enjoy his beer and the company around. Now, about 11:45, Aaron McKinney and Russell Henderson walk in. Now, I didn't know their names then, but they're the accused. They're the perps. They're the accused. So, they walk in, just very stone-faced, you know, dirty, grungy, rude, kidding, that type of thing. Now, they come in, and as you know, they came to the bar, and paid for a pitcher in dimes and quarters. That's $5.50 in dimes and quarters. That is a freaking nightmare. Now these two, they didn't really seem intoxicated at all. They came in, they took their beer, and they went and enjoyed themselves in the pool area. Now, a little bit later, I look and I see them just kind of moving around, no beer. And I remember thinking to myself, I'm not gonna ask them if they want another one, because they just paid for a pitcher in dimes and quarters. I have a real good feel now having no money.
Romaine Patterson, money meant nothing to Matthew because he came from a lot of it. I mean, he'd like hand over his wallet in 2 seconds because money meant nothing to Matthew. His shoes might have meant something. I don't know. They could say it was a robbery, but I don't believe it. Not even for an iota of a second.
Now, a few moments later, I look over and I see Aaron and Russell talking to Matthew.
Aaron said the guy walked up to him and said that he was gay and wanted to get with Aaron.
Kristen Price, girlfriend of Aaron McKinney.
And Aaron got aggravated and said that he was straight and didn't want anything to do with them. That's when Aaron and Russell went into the bathroom and decided to pretend they were gay to get the guy in the truck and rob him. They wanted to teach him a lesson. You don't come on straight, people.
Okay, no. They said that he came on to them. I absolutely, positively disbelieve and refute that statement 100%. I refute it. I'll give you two reasons why. One, character reference. Why them? He wasn't hitting on anyone else in the bar. I mean, you know, they say it was gay, a flaming gay. I mean, hello? I don't believe it. And two, territorialism is the term I use for that. And that would be the fact that Aaron and Russell were in the pool area. Matthew was just kind of sitting by himself out here. Upon first interaction, they were in Matt's area, so who approached two by that?
But Matthew was the kind of person, like, he could never not talk to someone for any reason. I mean, a stranger could walk right up and he'd just say, oh, blah, blah, blah. He had no problem striking up any kind of conversation.
Matt did feel lonely a lot of times. You know, Matt didn't know how dull Matt could be. He would have popped right into it. And the fact that he's a bar alone that his friends made that much more vulnerable.
Now, this is what I'm testifying to, and I'm basically the key eyewitness in this case, is so what I'm testifying to is that I saw Matthew leave. Now, I saw two guys leave with Matthew. I didn't see their faces. I only saw the backs of their heads. But at the same time, Aaron and Russell were nowhere to be found. So, you do the math.
Actually, I think the DJ was the last person to talk to Matthew that night. Give him a cigarette or something. His name is Shadow.
I was the last person to see Matt before he left the fire center. Just bullshitting around with my shit. All of a sudden, he walked up to me. No, I walked up to him. And he said, oh, what's up, man? What's up, Shadow? Getting ready to leave? I was like, oh, you know, man, this and that, da da da. And so, you know, he stood there, talked for like a good 10 minutes. And all of a sudden, you know, I see him getting like real anxious, you know? Like, anxious to leave and shit. So, he starts looking over at the door, you know? Two guys, you know, they're standing over there. And so, when he left, I saw it. He left with those two guys. They left in the truck. He sat in the front. He sat between the both of them. It was a black truck. And you know, when they left, I didn't think nothing of them. You know? I didn't think those guys were going to be like them.
I'm friend of Aaron McKinney. Oh. I've known Aaron a long time. Aaron was a good kid. I liked Aaron a lot. That's why I was shocked when I heard this. I'm like, I know he was living out far at his trail house, is what he told me, with his girl. They had just started dating last summer, and she must have gotten pregnant as soon as they started dating, you know? Because she had a kid. Aaron was only 21 years old, but he was running around with a kid. You see, that's just the kind of person Aaron was. Just like, he always wore, like, big clothes, you know, like Tommy Hilfiger, Polo, Gucci. At the time I knew Aaron, though, he was just a kid, you know, just trying to fit in, acting tough, acting cool. But you could get in his face about something, and he'd back down, just like he was some kind of scared kid.
Sherry Anderson. Russell was just so sweet. I mean, he was the one who was the Eagle Scout. His whole presence was just quiet and sweet. And I know people snap and whatever, and it wasn't a real intimate relationship we had. I was just his landlord. But I did work with him at the Chuck Wagon too, and I remember at our Christmas party, he was just totally drunk out of his mind. And I mean, we were all pretty much just like party town, but he wasn't belligerent. He didn't change, his personality didn't change. He was just the same little me, Russell. I remember him coming up to me and saying, can we get a chance, Sherry? Can I have a dance? Which, we never did get around to doing that, but now I just want to shake him, you know? Like, what in the hell were you thinking?
Well, I took off on my bicycle around 5 p.m. from my dorm on Wednesday. I just sort of felt like going for a ride, you know? So I headed up to Cactus Canyon. I don't really know the area that well, so on my way back down, I just sort of picked away and went. Which, now, it just sort of makes me think that God wanted me to find him, because there's no way I was going to go down that way. I mean, I was just deep ass sand, and I wanted to turn around, but for some reason I kept going. And there was this rock on the ground, and I drove it. I mean, I went over the handlebars, ended up on the ground. so I got up. I was sort of dusting myself off, looking around, when I noticed something, which ended up being Matt. He was lying there by a fence. I thought it was a scarecrow, though. I thought, you know, Halloween's coming up. It's probably just a Halloween gag. I didn't really think much of it. So I picked up my bike, and I walked around the fence, and I got closer to him. And that's when I noticed his hair. And that was the thing that really made me know it was a human being, was his hair, because I thought it was a dummy. I even noticed his chest moving up and down. I still thought it was a dummy, though. I thought it had to be like a mechanism or something. But when I saw his hair, I knew. So I ran. I ran as fast as I could to the nearest house, and I called the police.
I responded to the call. Officer Reggie Flutie. When I got there, at first, the only thing I could see was partially somebody's feet. So I got out of my vehicle and I raced over. And that's when I seen what appeared to be a young man, 13, maybe 14 years old, because he just looked so tiny, lying there on his back. The gentleman that was there, Matthew Shepherd, he was just covered in blood, and there was dry blood all underneath him. He was barely breathing, but he was doing the best that he could. I was gonna breathe for him, I couldn't get his mouth open. His mouth, it just wouldn't open for me. He was covered in, like I said, dry blood, and partially dry blood all over his head, and in fact, the only place that there wasn't any blood was under his eyes, where he'd been crying all night. His head was distorted, you know, it did not look normal. It looked like he had this really harsh head wound.
I was working the emergency room when Matthew Shepherd arrived. I don't believe any of us can remember seeing a patient in that type of condition before in a long time. We have some staff members that have worked in big city hospitals that have seen this type of condition before. However, some of us just haven't. And it's something you don't expect here. You expect to see this type of condition coming from a car going down the hill at 80 miles an hour. You expect to see gross, terrible, horrendous injuries from something like that. This awful, terrible thing.
There was nothing I could do. If there was anything I could have done, I would have done it. There was nothing. And I yelled at him at the top of my lungs, trying to get anything out of him. But like, hey, wake up! Hello! But he didn't move. He didn't flinch. He didn't anything.
He was tied to the fence. His hands were thumb out in what we call the cuffing position. It's the way we handcuff people. He was bound with this really thin white rope that went 3, maybe 4 inches off the ground. His shoes were missing. He was tied extremely tight. I even tried to use my boot knife to cut him free, but I had to be so careful not to hurt him any further.
Now, first thought is, well, certainly you'd like to think that this comes from a stranger who strolls through town and meets somebody. Things like this happen. Shit happens, and it happens in Laramie. However, someone's been beaten repeatedly like this. It's something that offends us. Yes, I believe it's a good word. It offends us.
He was bound so tight that when I finally got my knife through there and I put him onto his left side, he stopped breathing. And so immediately I put him onto his back and it was just enough of an adjustment. And he started to breathe again and I could cut him free. And that's when I seen the EMS unit trying to get to the location. And once they made it through there, we put Matthew on a backboard, we gave him a neck collar, and Rob drove into Ivinson Hospital's emergency room.
Now, strange thing is, 20 minutes before Matthew Shepherd arrived, Aaron King was brought in by his girlfriend. I guess he got into some fight back in town. So, working on Aaron, in comes Matthew. Now, at this point, I don't know if there's a connection at all. So I tell Aaron to wait to go and treat Matthew. There's Aaron McKinney, one room in the ER. Matthew Shepherd, 2 doors down. Now, we all saw Matthew. We knew his condition was beyond our capabilities. All the neurosurgeons down in the Valley. He was on the road an hour later.
They showed me a picture. Days later, I saw a picture of Matthew Shepard and I would have never recognized him.
Then, 2 days later, I found out that there was a connection. And I was very struck. They were two kids, they were both my patients, and they were two kids. I worked on both of them, of both their bodies, and for a brief moment, I wondered if this is how God feels when he looks down upon us. We are all his kids, and I felt a great deal of compassion for both of them.
Today our attention turns to Laramie, Wyoming, the Albany County Courthouse, where Aaron James McKinney and Russell Arthur Henderson are being charged with the brutal beating of Matthew Shepard, a gay University of Wyoming student.
The arraignment was on Friday, right around lunchtime, and I just said, I'm just going, and I just went. I walked a few blocks, and I went. And has anyone told you about the arraignment? There was about 100 people there from town, and just as many news and media. And by this time, a lot more of the facts had come out. The fact that the perpetrators were kids themselves, local kids, that everyone who's from around here has some sort of connection to, and what? I think everyone was waiting for what would happen when the perpetrators walked in. And what happened? They walked in their all orange jumpsuits and shackles and could have heard a pin drop. Was incredibly solemn, and the judge did a reading of the facts, of the evidence that the prosecution has, and it's just a statement of the facts. And it lasts 5 minutes tops, and many more material at this point, and the reading was.
The essential facts are that the defendants, Aaron James McKinney and Russell Arthur Henderson, met Matthew Shepard at the Fireside Bar. And after Mr. Shepard confided he was gay, the subjects deceived Mr. Shepard into following them to a remote area. Upon arrival at said area, the defendants tied the victim to a buck fence, robbed him, tortured him, and beat him. Later on, the subjects were contacted by officers of the Laramie Police Department. The officers found in the back of their pickup truck a credit card and a pair of black hat and leather shoes. The subjects stole the credit card and wallet containing $20, and later obtained the victim's address to later burglarize his home.
I don't think there was anyone in the room who wasn't crying at that point. I mean, it lasts 5 minutes tops. But just don't get more horrific. I mean, what?
Said defendants left the victim begging for his life. Both Aaron McKinney and Russell Henderson pled not guilty to charges. Gogo Funds, Chastity Pasley, and Kristen Price also pled not guilty after being charged with accessories at the event. On our next trip, we spoke to the chief investigating officer on the case.
I guess the thing that bothered me the most was going down to the Florida Valley where Matthew was. I guess the thing that bothered me the most was seeing him and touching him. As a homicide detective, you look at bodies, and this poor boy is sitting here fight all of his life, trying to make it, and I just wanted this one so bad.
I keep seeing that picture in my head from when I found it. And it's not pleasant whatsoever. I don't want it to be there. I just want to, like, get it out. That's the biggest thing for me, is seeing that picture in my head. And it's kind of unbelievable, you know, that I was the one that found it. Because the big question that I have, like, with my religion, is why did God want me to find it?
I know how to take care of myself, and I was irrationally terrified.
Captain Conway.
So what this means is not letting my 12-year-old walk the street. Seeing a truck make a U-turn and thinking, it's coming after me. Having to stop because I'm shaking so bad when in fact the truck was not coming after me. My reaction was to have my heart.
So, I guess no matter how you dice it, I did have an opportunity here.
Matt Galahad.
If I had amazing hindsight in 2020 to have stopped what occurred, and I don't know. You know, I just kept thinking, what was I doing when I was looking down at for those 20 seconds when I was washing dishes and these two guys were talking to Matt? The hell was I thinking?
So you do a lot of studying, and you can study for hours and hours and hours. You study and study and study. You check everything with your witnesses and your officers and make sure everything's on that same page. It all changes when I get this flash of seeing Matthew. I wanted it so tight that there is no way that these boys are going to get out of there.
One of the things that happened when I got to the fence, it was just such an overwhelming amount of blood. And we try to wear protective gloves. We really do. It's just, we had this cheap sheriff at the time, and he bought us these shit gloves. You know, you put them on, you put them on, and they just keep breaking. And so finally, you just run out of gloves, you know? But then you get there, and you see Matthew, and you try to help him, you know? Your mind tells you and says, don't hesitate. You know, you see Matthew, you try to find an airway, you know? That's what you do, you know? You don't hesitate, you know?
Now, the thing I wasn't telling you before is that Reggie is my daughter.
Much knowing.
And when she first told me she wanted to be a police officer, well, I thought there wasn't a better job for her. She could handle whatever came her way.
About a day and a half later, the hospital called me. They said Matthew has HIV. He says, you've been exposed, and you've had a bad exposure, you see? Because I've been building a lean-to for my llamas, and so my hands had all these open cuts on them, and so I was kind of screwed, you know? And you think, oh shoot, you know?
Would you like to talk about losing sleep?
And so I said this to the doctor, I says, well, what do I do? And he said, get up here. So I did, I went to the hospital, and we started the ATC drugs immediately.
Now, that's medication they told me that if administered within the first 36 hours, that it can maybe stop you from getting the disease.
That's a mean, nasty medicine. Mean, I lost 10 pounds and a lot of my hair.
And quite frankly, I've had to lash out at someone. Not Matthew. Please understand, not one of us was mad at Matthew, but I made one to squeeze McKinney's head off. Can you think about Henderson and how two complete human beings can cause so much grief for so many. It has been horrible for my whole family, but mostly for her and her kids.
I think it brought home to my girls what their mom does for a living.
Well, Reggie, you know what I'm gonna say next.
And my parents, you know, they both said the same damn thing.
You're quitting this damn job!
It's just a parent thing, you know? I mean, they're terribly proud of you, whether it's handling a drunk or handling a case like this.
Well, like I said, there's a right way, a wrong way, then there's Reggie's way. And
so finally, I just looked at her and I said, for God's sake, Francis, she's just lying up!
You are so stubborn!
You know me, stubborn! And I just say, okay, that's your opinion, but now here's mine. I mean, I'm 39 years old. What are you gonna do? Spank me?
Don't give me any ideas, Reggie.
It looked pretty funny, you know? I mean, what can they say?
I just hope she doesn't go before me. I just wouldn't be able to handle that.
Listen, listen, listen to my heart song. Listen, listen, listen to my heart song. I will never forget you. I will never forsake you. I will never forget you. I will never forsake you.
I went to the candle vigil.
Zameda Allah.
And it felt so good to be with people who felt like shit. I kept feeling like I don't deserve to feel this bad, you know? And then someone got up there and said, come on guys, let's show the world that Laramie is not this kind of a town.
Listen, listen, listen to my heart song. Listen, listen, listen to my heart song.
But it is that kind of town. I mean, if it wasn't that kind of town, then why did it happen here? I mean, like, that's a lie, because it happened here.
Listen, listen, listen to my heart song. Listen, listen, listen to my heart song.
I mean, that's like looking at an Escher painting and getting all confused. It's just like totally circular logic, you know? And we have to be sad that we live in a town, a state, a country where shit like this happens.
I will never forget you. I will never forsake you. I will never forget you. I will never forsake you.
And I'm not going to step away from that and say, we need to show the world this didn't happen. I mean, these are people trying to distance themselves from the crime. And we need to own the crime. I feel everyone needs to own it. We are like this.
Listen, listen, listen to my heart song. Listen, listen,
we are like this.
I was very moved when I saw the tag at the end of the homecoming parade.
Shepherd. And so the parade went down to the end of the street to make a U-turn, and I went to the other side of my apartment to watch.
So, I was around the area where they had the banner for Matthew, and let me tell you, I've never had goosebumps so long in my entire life. I mean, it was amazing. A mass of people, families, mothers, and these six-year-old kids tying these armbands around these six-year-old kids, and, you know, it, just explaining them why this word armbands, it really was one of the most beautiful things I've ever done in my entire life.
Well, sure enough, about 10 minutes went by, and the parade started coming down the other side of the street, and I saw the most incredible thing. The number of people marching for Matthew Shepherd had grown 5 times. There were 500 people marching for Matthew Shepherd. 500 people! Can you imagine? And you know what? I started crying. Tears were streaming down my face, and I thought, thank God I got to see this kind of support in my lifetime. My second thought was, thank you, Matthew.
Now, I haven't been all that involved, per se. My husband's a highway patrolman, so that's really how I feel about it. Now, when I first found out about it, I just thought it was horrible. I mean, no one deserves that. I don't care who you are. But at the same time that this happened, that highway patrolman was killed. And there was nothing. Nothing. They didn't say anything about the man that killed him, and he was old, and he was driving, and he shouldn't have been driving, and he killed him. And it was just a little piece in the paper, and we lost one of our guys. My husband worked with him. He was brand new on the force, and here's one of ours, and it was just a little piece in the paper. Now, a lot of it is my feeling that the media is portraying Matthew Shepherd as a saint and a martyr, and I just don't think he was that pure, you know. Between everything that's come out about him, about his character, and the spreading AIDS, and just the kind of person he was, you know, being a barfly, and I think he pushed himself around. I think he flaunted it. Now, everybody's got their problems, but why they exemplify him, I don't know. What's the difference if you're gay? A hate crime is a hate crime. If you murder someone, you hate them. What's the difference if you're gay or a prostitute or whatever? I don't understand. I just don't understand.
Matthew Shepherd Medical Update, 4:30 a.m. Monday, October 12th.
At 12 midnight, on Monday, October 12th, Matthew Shepherd's blood pressure began to drop. We immediately notified his family, who were already at the hospital. At 12:53 a.m., Matthew Shepherd died. His family was at his bedside. The family then wanted me to release the following statement. The family again asked me to express their sincere gratitude towards the entire world for the overwhelming response for their son. The family is glad that they did not have to make a decision regarding whether or not to continue life support for their son. Like a good son, Matt was carried to the end and removed all guilt or stress from the family. Matt came into the world premature and left the world premature. Matthew's mother said, go home! Give your kids a hug! And don't let a day go by without telling them that you love them. Let me tell you something. If they put those two boys to death, they'll be going back on everything that would be thinking about them. That would want to leave them with hope. H-O-P-E. Just as the whole world hoped that Matt would survive. The whole thing. This whole thing, you see, ropes around hope. H-O-P-E.
Thank you.
how we did the show, Sam picked it up. So.
We are doing the Addams Family.